Yeah, thank you. We are now going to talk about the farm map online, for short called GPI, and we have another program called Regional Environment Program called RMP. Both of the programs are a success in Norway. They are used a lot and they work very well. Open source has been a main contribution to that success as we see it. A couple of words. I work at the Norwegian Forest and Landscape Institute. And they provide information about soil, forest, and do some research around that. I am a developer. My name is Lars Opsahl. First, we're going to say a couple of words about applications so you know what we talk about. The first application is GPI, the Farm Map Online application. It's a web client. It's it's a major tool for the farmers to collect information about their farms. That means area information, informations about what kind of soil it is, and so on. It also contains information about ownership, and it has different reports for printing, etc. Here's a short picture of the application. You see here, you have kind of area numbers. You can't probably see it, but it's there. And there's the ownership information. Is it anything to point with here? Is it any pointer or not? There was one, okay. I tried this one. Here you see different ownership information. You have advanced printing of properties, and you can do a search on any property in Norway. I said it was mainly used by farmers, but it's also used by private persons because it contains information about all properties in Norway. It's open, so it's easy to use for everybody. It's also used a lot by community employed or governmental employed that work with agriculture. One thing in Norway is that farms seem to be bigger and bigger. So we need to group properties together because you rent a neighbor farm or something. So that is new functions that are coming now, that you construct your own farms. You group together all kinds of farms until you have the correct area that you actually are growing on. Yes. The next application is called Regional Environment Program. That is also an application that takes some information from many different sources and presents it to the user through a web client. This is a client only used by farmers. And they use that to apply for subsidies. This application replaced all paperwork this summer. So a farmer cannot use paper to apply for subsidies anymore. He has to do it on a web client. That, of course, means if you're going to apply for money, we need to know who you are. So we have to integrate with MinID, or it's a national system for authentication. This system is used by external systems. So external systems connect to this system to get the information that the farmers draw on the maps. I can show you a short overview here. This is some of the complicated part. Like in Norway, there's about 100 different ways to apply for subsidies for. And from region to region, that varies. So in one region, you may have 50, in another region, 70, This application, it's the same application used all around in Norway. So it behaves differently according to where your farm is. So according to which region your farm is located in, you get different choices for applications. Here you have applied for grasdekt vannvei. Yeah, everybody know what that is. Yeah, that's good. That's a kind of subsidizing. So we have many different choices there. Where you can apply for that kind of subsidizing is kind of difficult to know even for farmers and even for the government employee. So it was a problem earlier because they're really not actually saying, can I apply here or here or here? No, you can only apply at this area. So the system creates a legal area for the farmers to draw on. So if you actually made a road, like he has done here, he draws the road. And if he tries to draw on the outside, it's cut off. So that helps the farmers to make correct application, and it saves the community a lot of work to control the application afterwards. And of course, you can edit the geometries, and you can delete them or do whatever you want with them. And that until a certain date, because after a certain date, the application is closed, and the farmers get their money back. Now, back to 2012. We had a very old static HTML client, and they wanted that fixed. They wanted a more dynamic and faster and more functionality in that client. We had a requirement specification ready. We had 4 months of development time. And we had about 4 to 5 programmers available. Some of them are sitting here. Software investments had to be clarified early in the project. And since the short time frame, we had to work on client and server in parallel. And at Skogelandskap, where I work, there is, we are use open source if that's available. But now we are going to turn this situation a little bit around. Let's say use only commercial software. Let's see what will happen with the project then. And we also wanted to install by only certified engineers. So we didn't take any risks on anything. The workflow would look like something like this. First, we had to use some time to figure out what kind of software to use. And then we had to wait for price quotas from the vendors. And the price varies quite a bit from case to case. It's quite impossible to tell the price before you actually have the correct runtime environment you're going to run on. And we had to wait for internal discussions regarding prices. You really mean that you need 100,000 bucks to buy this? Well, in our organization, that was like impossible. And then it needs handling licensing misunderstandings. Like you mean you run this on VMware, which have 64 CPUs? Okay, then I have to pay for 64 CPUs, even if you only use 2 CPUs on your host OS. And then we have to wait for the engineers to install the software. Then we could start the code. Well, you know what the result would be? Yes, it would be failed. And because one reason, the coding would be late by weeks, and another reason, it wouldn't be money for it. We would just continue to run the old application with no changes, and that would continue to run until it wasn't possible to use it anymore. So, and another reason, it would have been too expensive. Like we had to rob a bank to get money for that software we needed for that project. There's a silver lining, which means a hidden benefit here. As a developer, I wouldn't be blamed for it, the project failure. Because I was only waiting on external resources, money, so it wasn't my fault. I would have a nice spring, quiet spring, and walk around. So, but some might say that is bad planning. You should know that you needed like $1 million this spring to software, but that's the opportunities you get when you work with open source. Because like if we should stopped in 2011 with the project we worked on, then we had to get a team together, start to plan this project, and find out what kind of different software we needed, what kind of protocols we needed, and that would mean an interruption in the current working project. But with open source, we can do it like this. Say, here's your project. hopefully you find open source that you can use, and then we don't have to take all the budget discussions. They are already taken, or we have the amount of money we need, because we don't need so much money. Let's do a comparison. So we did go for open source, and this is some of the server-side components we used. We used CentOS for all servers. We used PostGIS, PostgreSQL, Postgres, and GIS Server and Map Server, Java Spring, and Heimlich Spatial. That is not very often mentioned. That's a very good tool, Heimlich Spatial. It works very well. And if you work on a set of tables, like if you work with 10,000 different tables, and you never work on the same table, Heimlich Spatial is not the tool or the package. But if you work on a set of tables, a small set of tables, and you know you are going to do a lot of work on them, Heimlich Spatial is quite nice. It works very well. And another thing with Hibernate is that a lot of consultants know Hibernate. So like if you like take GIA tools to consultants, they don't really know about it, but Hibernate they know about. The new GPL application, it was launched in June 2012, and the development was done on Scrum-based. We used Svan and we used Maven. The Maven tool is very efficient, as you probably know. It solves a lot of problems. Creates some, but solves the most of them. And people were developing on Windows, Fedora, Ubuntu. That was no problems. So it works very well. To get the system up, we had a client interface ready in about 2 weeks. And that was done by using XSDs and Spring to generate web services. We use temp data in Postgres using generic data tables. And that works okay, like because we are storing tables, data that looks alike, pretty much the same, but it's different kind of data. So we didn't have to create like 10 tables, we created one table, and we had metadata about what those tables were. We could, of course, like use an in-memory database there, like MongoDB or whatever, or BerkeleyDB, like a hash table database. But the reason why we use Postgres for temporary data is that those data are going to be viewed in GIA Server and Map Server later. So it's much easier to connect to Postgres by GIA Server and Map Server. We did run quite a bit of integration tests and stress tests. And the importance of stress tests is of course, it's important. But we actually did run many thousand farms. So we got the system well tested before we went to production. And since farms can be put together by many farms and by many properties, we talk about many hundred properties, and to compute ownership, you have to check properties against properties, so it's a kind of complicated check, it takes some time, so we have to use a lot of concurrency to get it through, or else you have to wait in minutes. And of course, you have to handle topology errors in SQL and Java. Let's do a comparison between commercial and open source. Here's the commercial solution. If you go for Microsoft, Oracle Enterprise, ArcGIS, WebLogic, and TopLink on the open source, you know it. We go for this very simple solution to save money. It wouldn't work though, but it's simple and So we have two servers, one database, one application server, and one VMS VFS server. This would, of course, cost something. And here's the price for open source at the bottom and commercial software on the top. There's some percentages difference there. And I'm pretty, I can't guarantee for the prices, because like if you read the S3 price side, like, hey, we can't say what the price are because there's so many different factors. So it's quite impossible to put the price on the web. We actually have to see our server and find out what the price is. And it's pretty much that with many other systems, because it's like it's, if you want to find the price, okay, thanks. We go on. There's also one difference between governmental and non-profit and private organizations. Like, heavy load on private sites usually means more revenue. But on governmental and non-profit organizations, more traffic do not really mean higher revenue. Of course, you may get some more hardware, but like, there's no automatic relation between traffic and revenue. Was that the previous one? See. Yeah. Okay. How can we say that open source increased stability and performance? Because we could scale up the system with no extra cost. Like, if we had gone for the first solution, you get to August, where the traffic is high, we are up about 500,000, more than 500,000 requests total. And you have to ask for more money, and you have to get an engineer to install the software, it will be a failure. So it was not difficult to scale up the system from the beginning, because it didn't cost us anything. It's easy to install, just take the servers, put them up, and we are ready for traffic in August. Like, if you buy an extra Oracle license for a 64 CPU, you hopefully use it. We also did a lot of horizon scaling. It's easy on this system because of because of the nature of the data and the usage. Here's the system as it is now. There's some more servers, but we won't go in details here. There's one more here. Another thing with open source is that it makes it easy to add new functionality. Because you might buy a system, and you cannot buy enterprise system. So we have to add new functions all the time, and that costs money. But usually here it's very easy to just find a plugin, add it, dump it into your system, and you are up running. Like, we needed JSON support. It was very easy. We just took Jackson package from Faster XML, and we run that on the Java objects, and we suddenly have a JSON. It was very easy. For integration, we used OpenIM with the Mine ED. Yes, these functions are added after the GPI project. This is different servers in the system and the interfaces. One important thing in this slide is that standards. Without standards, it would be impossible to do it. So the importance for the open source community to support standards is like we should do more of. Because if proprietary software use their own standards, it's no way to get in there. Like, this is written in LibreOffice. I try to open it in what's it called, Microsoft. It doesn't look like, looks like hell. So you have to support that. Is there any drawbacks with open source? Yes, there is of course some drawbacks, but from my point of view, there are not any real drawbacks. Because, like, you can say that with commercial software, you can call a guy and say, hey, I bought some software from you, it doesn't work. But usually the answer is, it isn't my fault, it's a file via disk, your network, or you use the software wrong. But the farmer at the end doesn't really care if you run on open software or commercial software, or if it's a programming file from your side, or like the cause of the fault doesn't care for the end customer. So if you see the perspective from the corporate or from the organization's level, it's not important. But if you have to be you have to take some chances yourself. Like, there is nobody to call to blame, but usually there isn't a problem. I see, like, there's much less fault in open source, and of course you have to test it, but that's a part of your job to test it. Like, some say that you may get a refund, but as far as I know, it's very seldom you get a refund from Oracle because there is a bug in Oracle. So, and you have paid so much money already, so we'll never get back the amount of money you paid in. And who will help me to fix any problems? There's plenty of people out there that will help me. And that works very well. We have contributed some ourselves, but there's also always an answer. And I have very seldom been the first person to have this error. Usually there is a person before that had the error, and Google finds it for me. Yeah, we've been through those. Like, hopefully you agree on that. It helped us a lot, and all those points made it possible to develop those applications. Thanks.
Hey, Klaus, we've got time for some questions.
Yes?
You mentioned that you're running Postgres and PostGIS on CentOS.
Yes.
We have done that in our own organization. We found it to be difficult to set up. Was that your experience?
No. It works without any problems. Easy to install.
Okay, I might ask you.
Yeah, sure.